Hi, and welcome to the Semites Podcast. I'm Chris Torrance. In today's episode, I want to talk about a bug that was recently discovered in my Apple II emulator. So let's get started. Mark Golombek and Dan Henderson have been making a name for themselves recently by writing Apple II software to test various hardware and software configurations. In particular, they have a couple different tools that are available on their website at 8bitshack.org. They have the Identify, which is an application to identify the hardware that you have on an Apple II, as well as any peripheral cards. And then they also have a newer one called Apple Core, which is used to test your 6502 chip in your computer. And if you're interested in gaming, they also have their Angry Birds for the Apple II. Recently, Mark Golombek logged a bug on my Apple II emulator by running the Apple Core software against it. The software tests whether your 6502 or 6502 chip is working properly, and it's available as either a physical floppy disk that they'll mail to you or as a digital download. You can use this to test either real hardware or, in my case, to test your emulator to see if it's working properly. You'd like to think that as a developer, if a bug report comes in, you of course would immediately assume, there must be something wrong with my code and go about fixing it. But of course, like most developers, my first reaction was, well, that can't be right. There must be something wrong with the tool. I better check this out myself. So I downloaded a copy of the Apple Core software and tried it out in my emulator. For those of you that don't know, I've been writing an Apple II emulator that's available over at apple2ts.com. It emulates an Apple IIe with a floppy disk card, a hard drive card, a mocking board, a printer, as well as a MIDI interface, and it also includes some features for debugging. I'm actually going to be running this today in my local version so that I can demonstrate the bug as well as the fix. So let me go ahead and click on the disk icon, and I'll load up the Apple Core floppy disk here, and then just hit the boot button, and this will boot the ProDOS disk. Okay, so here is the Apple Core software. We want to test against a 6502 since that's what our chip is emulating. So I'm going to hit 2, and this will bring up the test menu for the program. And what this will do is this will run through about 21 tests for all of the different instructions on the 6502, including all of the addressing modes for each instruction. So let's go ahead and just hit start test. And you can see at the top there, it's just running through tests. So increment, store. Whoops. We've run into an error, and it says that it is with the bit instruction, and it won't go any further until I've fixed this. So this was the bug report that Mark Golombek logged against my emulator. So you might ask, well, what the heck is the bit instruction? It must have something to do with bits, and you would be correct. If we take a look at Assembly Lines, the complete book by Roger Wagner, we can read about the bit instruction. And in particular, this one seems pretty complicated. Roger says, fully understanding the function and various applications of this instruction is a sign of having arrived as an assembly language programmer and suggests that you are probably the hit of parties, thrilling your friends by doing hex arithmetic in your head and reciting ASCII codes on command. So I'm not sure if I'm quite at that stage yet, but I'll try and explain what the bit operator actually does. In particular, it tests for various bits in memory and whether they're on or off. If we take a look at the next page in the book, we can see kind of what happens when you do this. So basically, you take the bit operator and you compare it to a location in memory. And what this actually does is several things. In particular, it takes bits 7 and 6 from that memory location, and it loads them directly into the N and V registers. This is the negative and the overflow registers. The next thing the bit instruction does is compares all of the bits in the memory location with the accumulator. If any of the bits match, then it clears the zero register. If none of the bits match between those two, then it goes ahead and it sets the zero register. You can use BITten then to test whether any bits are on at that particular memory location by just loading those particular bits in the accumulator, calling the BITten instruction, and then using, say, for example, BNE, the branch on not equal instruction, and that will actually take the branch if any of the bits match. The cool thing about the BITten instruction is that it doesn't actually affect the accumulator also. And so this has some uses in, say, clearing the keyboard strobe, where you can just call BIT and it won't have any side effects of destroying the accumulator. Now, if we look at the table here, it says that the flags and registers affected are memory is loaded into the N and V flags, and then also the Z flag gets set depending on the results. None of the other registers get affected. So if we go over to my emulator code, you can see now I'm in my instructions.ts file. So this is all TypeScript here. I have a function called doBIT, and this is just a helper function to handle all of the different addressing modes. This takes the value at the memory location and then just does a simple AND to test whether the bits match or not. Here we're setting the zero flag. If any of the bits match, then we're going to set the zero flag to off. If none of the bits match, in other words, when we AND it, we get zero, then we're going to turn the zero flag on. And then the negative and overflow flags just get set to the memory locations for bits 7 and 6. So that's all pretty straightforward. You can see here the different addressing modes. Here's zero page relative, absolute. Here's immediate, which we'll get to in a minute. And then here's some of the relative ones, zero page X, absolute X. Now, that all seems fine, and that's how I had it coded up. However, the test is still failing. And the reason why is because some of these are new addressing modes. The original 6502 only had zero page absolute, but you can see that there's three new ones that were added for the 6502: immediate, zero page X, and absolute X. If we turn to the appendix in the back of the book, here we have the 6502 instruction codes, and I have it spelled out what status flags are actually affected. And here is the bug. If we look for zero page X and absolute X, it's still the same three flags. However, for immediate, only the zero flag is set. The negative and the overflow are not actually set by immediate mode. Immediate mode is when you're comparing the accumulator with a value rather than a memory location. So this is the problem with the emulator, is I was just assuming that all three flags were getting affected as opposed to just one flag. Let's see now if we can fix this. If we go back to my code, I've got my do bit here, but I don't want to do that because that's going to actually set all three of these. Instead, what I want to do is only set the zero flag depending on the value. So I'm just going to paste that in directly. So we take the value in, which is the immediate value. We set the zero flag accordingly, whether any of the bits match or not. And let's go ahead, we'll save this. I'll go back to my emulator. You can see that because I'm running it dynamically using Node, that it automatically reloaded the emulator. I'll go ahead and reload the Apple Core disk, and I'll speed it up here so it goes a little faster. So we're going to boot the disk. Okay, we'll do test number two. I'll put it back to regular speed and I'll start the test. And here we go, up 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay. And you can see it made it past the bit failure. And now it's just going to go ahead and do the rest of the tests. So we'll see what happens once those go. Sure enough, that was the problem. You can see tests were successful. I had zero errors. There were a couple tests that were skipped. This is the TSB and TRB tests, and those are not actually available on a lot of 6502s. I think they were only those instructions were only available on the Rockwell and WDC chips, which I'm not trying to emulate, so those tests just get skipped. So we managed to fix the problem with the bit instruction. Everything seems to be working properly. We can now confidently load up whatever software we want and assume that it's going to work successfully. I don't know how many programs actually use that bit in immediate mode, but I can imagine if they did, it would have been a really subtle bug to track down. And I don't know how hard that would have been without something like Mark and Dan's software. So I'd like to thank both of them for writing it and actually running it against my emulator. And I'm sure they were very happy to have found a bug because that's, of course, the whole point of the software. Thanks for watching this episode. If you're not currently a subscriber to my YouTube channel, please hit the subscribe button below. Also, I have a Patreon if you'd like to support me further, and I'll have a link in the show notes to that. And I'll put a link in the show notes as well to the Apple Core software and my emulator. Once again, thanks for watching.